के मैलक वर्सेस वी मैलक दी लिनक्स चैनल. सो यू कैन गो देयर एंड यू कैन सी देयर सम कपल ऑफ एपिसोड्स आई हैव डन. दिस इज क्वाइट लॉन्ग बैक, इट इज 2016. वन अनदर अपडेट आई हैव डन अराउंड जनवरी 2017. सो सम बंच ऑफ वीडियोस. So we can come back and we need some of this thing. K Malik, go there and if you see the documentation, you need to pass the access this thing. Yeah, see the action modifier. So you have all this GFP weight and all this. Let me just zoom this ZFP weight and you need to set one of this. So since it is not any DMA, it is not something like we are using any interrupts, nothing like that. This is not even atomic. So this is none of it. So it is a very simple, option, which is kernel. You can use, I think, even GFP user also. So it is fine. Either of that, it should work fine. So go here and you can put GFP kernel. And it should do the allocation. Again, we can do a test compile. And we should able to find that it is allocating. See, you can see there it is doing the allocation successfully. What we do is, since it is a kernel space, we need to be careful about this garbage collection, because in user space it is not an issue. Even if you have any memory leaks, it will be anyway taken care once you kill the process, okay? But in the kernel space it should be taken much serious, okay? So you need to do this manual garbage collection. So k free and you can pass this you can pass this buffer. There is some issue with this keyboard. Let me reconnect and see. Yes, so you can pass this and again you can do a test compile. Hopefully it should work. Let me see if any battery has an issue. Let me swap this. Yep. So we do this make and you can see it is, so far it is working fine. So we are still sticking with the compliance and our code is compliant. See, this is how you could you can do. So like any other malloc, you can of course do this part. This thing LZO mem is equal to null or something, you can handle that. Again, this you can refer how others are doing. Luckily, because we have this usage of that thing which someone is doing here. See, you can see their LZO mem, and then if not LZO mem and all that, you have all these routines. So it kind of gives a fair idea. So same thing, you can do this if it is null and do something. I don't need to do exit and all in my case, because I will do anyway sanity check elsewhere, okay? So it is fine actually. So it is fine. Or I can just do, maybe if not, I can do a return of zero there itself, and so it will be going out of the kernel module. So return of zero and it will be out of the kernel module. So now comes the question of our sample buffer, okay, which we are intended to compress, okay. See, what we do is, we can of course do another kmalloc and stuff like that. Instead, I can do anyway, we can use anyway arrays, okay. So let's create one array. Since it's just 1000 bytes, we can create an array. It's not that safe in kernel space, as long as the array size is not more than 500 or 600 bytes, but it's fine because it's a test code. Let's not complicate, okay? So we do unsigned char source buff, and let's give us size of 1000 bytes, and src buff length is going to be 1000 bytes, okay? And we can do an hash define max buff something, and then we can tell it is 1000 bytes, and replace this magic number with max buff, okay? And then we can do is unsigned unsigned int and then src buff length. This is a common nomenclature I do use, equal to zero, something like that. You can allocate, because since we have the maximum buffer and we are not sure how far we actually use that buffer, so you can allocate, you can assign zero and assign 1000 or whatever in the runtime, or you can just assign it here with this max buff. So same thing happens destination buffer, okay, DHT buffer, where you compress and put it in the DHT buffer, okay. And we can put the same thing, and DHT buff length is zero, and we can create another intermediate DHT buff like 2, right? So DHT 2 buff length. So we have 2 intermediate buffer. So you compress this, put it in DHT buffer, and again you uncompress it, put it in DHT 2 buffer, okay. So something like that, okay. Something like that you can do. So here is where we can start populating our data structure. So it gets interesting. So what we do is a mem set, and we can set the entire buffer with a fixed characters. Instead of 100,000 bytes, we can use up to 800 bytes, let's assume. So what we do is max buff, and we use another hash define, something like test buff or something, okay, test buff, and in that 1000 bytes we use this 800 bytes as test area. So memset src buff 0xAA. So we put some constant character, repeating character, so that we can get maximum compression possible in that algorithm, because it's a repeating pattern, okay. So we do this, and we need to pass this test buffer size, so that much of bytes we are initializing to this. So you can mimic, instead of memset, you can imagine you are receiving a file contents or some block contents in a driver, something like that. You can put it in this buffer, and you will know the size of that or length of that chunk, okay. So that's what same thing we are doing, and we can now assign this source buff length is 800, because we know so and so is what we are using out of this 1000 bytes, okay. So test buff is that. So hope you know by now, I generally type known, predictable, expected chunks of code in single lines. So this is my style of coding, and I do know people do write in multiple lines. I feel that since the monitors are having this type of form factor, which is horizontal, and we are no more using old CRT monitors, I feel this is a better way to write a code which is more modern and sophisticated, rather than doing same code which have been done in 1980s. So let's just adapt, okay. So I do this type of coding standard, because it kind of, I feel it is justifying this type of huge monitors what we have these days, okay. So you have that, and it should be taken care. Again, we can do a sample compile. Hopefully it should compile, okay. You can see there it got compiled, which means whatever buffers we allocated, everything, it is compiled. Luckily, since we are using fixed arrays, we don't need to do another k-free or something like that. So that's the advantage of using arrays which are predictable, rather than we use a dynamically allocated memory space with this thing. So you can, of course, in kernel it is not suggested to use something like that. It is good in kernel space, usually you do a dynamic allocation, but if you know that this chunk of memory you need it throughout the operation of kernel, you can as well use arrays as well, okay. So we did this memset, and then we can call the compression API, okay. You can go here, and we can go here. Yes, this is the header file. You can see there LZO1X1 compress and LZO RLA compress. So there are two variants are there. Of course, you can read the documentation. Typically, I do use this quite often. I'm saying something. My history is my past, which is around 5-6 years back or even more. So generally, I use this. So I'm kind of taking that as a sample. We go here. And what we do is we do this LZO1X compress. So we just need to populate this API with our data structure. See source buffer, pass the source buffer, length, pass this length. Okay. Of course, you can pass the test buff instead of that variable. But as I said, when I started the episode, we write something which is written like a professional code. Okay, not like some student sample garbage. Okay. So pass this, and destination is the one of the destination buffers we can pass. Okay, so DHT buff. So which means from source whatever is compressed it is going to come here, and from here whatever is decompressed it is going to come here. Which means ideally the source buffer and destination two buffers should both match. Okay, once the whole exercise is over. So we pass this thing. And DHT buff length is supposed to be, we need to know the output of that. So it's a simple matter of common sense. We need to do a pass by reference, right? So we need to pass its address, and we need to pass finally the work memory. Okay, so this is the thing, this work mem, LZO work mem. So it's a huge buffer we need to pass. So it is going to take the source buff and it is apply this. It is going to apply this compression algorithm, and when it is doing that, it is going to do that work in the work memory. And finally, once it is all done, it's going to put back in this destination buffer. So that's the idea. Yep, that's what. And here, what we do is we can do a debug print printf or sorry print k. And we can do a print of this sample, say for instance percentage d source buff length and comma this dash buff length, we can print. So we will come to know how much it is able to compress, the ratio of compression and stuff. Okay, so colon percentage d backslash n. And then we can pass this, okay. Yes, so we can do a print, sample print. So we will come to know how much it is efficient enough, okay. Of course, you can compute in percentage level and stuff like that. It's quite easy. Destination by source into 100 or something, you'll get the percentage of compression. And of course, from that, you can find also the ratio of compression and stuff like that, okay. So that's the whole idea, and the kernel, the module is over. We can test it. Okay, of course we can. Next try is the decompression. Before that, we can test this kernel module. Some error it is getting, incompatible pointer type. So let us go and find. Yeah, you can see there it is size t of pointer. We can do one thing. We can replace this with size t, or maybe we can just do a typecast. It should work anyway the same, size underscore t star, because it is actually unsigned int star, we are typecasting to size t. Okay, so hopefully it should work. Okay, yes, size t underscore star. Yeah, see, that's what you can replace this unsigned int itself as size t. It is up to you. Okay, I'm just doing this way so that I don't need to change these things actually. Okay. So let's again do a compile and see how it does. Yep, it got compiled. What we do is we can do a quick run. We can just do sudo insmod this packet drop.ko, and before we do that, we capture that log messages here, tail minus f where log kernel log. Yep, so we can capture it here. as you see here, we got an error. It says that unsigned unknown symbol in the module. So we are not sure what could be causing this error, which means there is some API or something, or something it is not, you know, been recognized. This type of error is quite common. Sometimes you pick some random internet kernel module code and then compile in your recent kernel in laptop, and then you run, then you may get some errors like this, which means you need to port it, or it is not compatible with your current kernel version. So in this case, since it is done from scratch, we can easily identify or try to identify what it is causing this problem. Okay, see, the thing is, when you do, you know, development like this, the big thing is, when you really do coding of your own, you do get errors like that. And the thing is not about whether you can code, write the code. The most important thing is you need to go through and you need to fix each and every issue like this, and then you need to get your overall code ready to use, or you make it work. Okay, so let's just debug. Okay, what we do is, that error, we are not sure it is coming from this first line and or it is coming from this this API call from where. Okay, so we are really not sure. What we do is, we just completely comment this part and we try compiling only that kmalloc part, because the kmalloc has that hash define which is inside the Linux lvo.h, things like that. So if this should work, this should be there defined, and so on, and then this gfp kernel also. So I'm not sure what is that error it is causing. So what we do is, we can recompile this and we try to do insmod this time, and hopefully it gets inserted. Okay, see. Yeah, see there, it got inserted, which means that is working fine. Okay, we go here. Still it shows unknown symbol and LZO1X compress and stuff. Tainted kernel. Which means, see, as it shows, it is looking for this module license. So license is not mentioned. So what I can do, sudo rmod packet drop, I can do. And I can add one module license if needed. Okay, the module license is quite simple. You need to mention it is GPL and who is the author and description and stuff, which again we can go to one of these and we can pick some sample. We can go down and something like that, we can just copy paste something like this. Okay, just paste it here, GPL, and you can mention this is compression algorithm test or demo something, and then you can put alias crypto, and sometimes you may have this author and stuff, the additional optional metadata. Okay, so in this case I don't need to give a module alias crypto. Alias crypto I don't need. I can just comment it or remove this line. Let us see if it works, and let us see if it works without this error. Okay, so let us see once more. We try, I'm sorry, let me just remove it. Once more we try to compile, and we do an insmod, and we see if it is coming once more. Yeah, looks like it is not coming. This may be the issue which I have done this thing insmod before this. So I can recheck rmod, and we go here. So we are in this line, and we try this insmod once more, and hopefully it should not repeat. Yeah, you can see there it is not repeating. So I can do an rm mode, so which means the module insert and module exit is fine as of now. Okay, again I'm saying, this is why when you do development, it's not that writing code is important. It is more important to do is compile your code, and even more important is the code should run. Okay, so come up, and what we do is we do step by step. See, this is test buff, and this thing, you need to pay attention. Sometimes this max buff and test buff may be predefined elsewhere in the Linux kernel, so you may have issues like namespace and other stuff. So perhaps we can avoid that by putting some underscore or stuff like that. I'm not sure. You can do that, since if it is something like whenever you have static APIs, so Like, you know, we have the static functions. Okay, sometimes some of those static functions are local functions of that .c file. Such functions usually people do, you know, put underscore, which means it's like a helper API stuff. Perhaps we can try that. Okay, we just try with this memset alone. Hopefully that should work. That is not an issue. I suspect this LZO1 compress is what is causing the error. Let's revisit here LZO.h. Here it is there, LZO1 compress, and it is there. So it is all defined here. Okay, hopefully it should work. If not, maybe the kernel has this thing not enabled. Who knows? Okay. So it is a complete different level. In that case, perhaps I may not be successful, you know, doing this. Okay. Let's do a make once more. And see, in this case, we are just doing a memset, nothing else. Okay. Max buff, of course, it is now underscore max buff, src buff. Yes, test buff. And here should be underscore. So it's quite common in kernel, you will find the namespace clash. It is not a common thing in user space, because you know it is what you are the one may start that, you know, user space code. And in case if you work in a large company and you are adding your modules in a existing user space code, then you may find some errors, namespace errors. Somewhere there may be a global variable, you may define some local variable which may have the same name as the global variable, so and you may get such errors. But in kernel it is quite common, you may get some namespace errors, because there may be a global variable in one of the header files and which we may be using or read declaring that name in our thing without knowing that it has been done already. Okay. It got compiled, and let's try. And you can see there it is working fine. This we can ignore. This is not because of this. It is not because of this. And what we do is we can just remove this module, and we can come back here, and we can now uncomment this line actually, because I suspect this is the line causing the whole issue. So it is quite simple. This is the API source buff destination buff, and this is the pointer of destination buff length, and which we are typecasting to size t of star, and this LZO work mem, which is nothing but a buffer. Okay, rather than calling as pointer, I like to call it as a buffer. Okay, so I know some people will call this as pointer, I like to call it as a buffer, because this is not a pointer. We are using this as a buffer, and of course a buffer will be pointed with a pointer. Okay, so that's what we just try to compile once again. Hopefully it should get you can see that the API also works, and we didn't got any errors, which means perhaps it is working fine. Okay, so I can do sudo rm mod, and what we do is we can continue with this printk, which means it is solved. Okay, so yeah, it is solved. So it is the whole error, it is coming because who knows, maybe it is expecting the module license, because it depends, as we use the open source components, it may expect the module license, who knows. Okay, so that's what we go back and we compile. Yeah, in smod you can see there now it worked fine. And you can see there 800 bytes, and it got all the way compressed, lossless compression to 31 bytes. So how cool is that? Okay, so you can see, take a calculator and compute 31 divided by 800, which is 0.03 into 100. So it is 3.8%, okay, is what we got eventually, minus 100. So 96% we have saved, okay, by having that repeated pattern. So it is quite significant. If you have a file system, and if there are some files padded with zeros, if you have any BMP files, and on the fly, you know, when you copy into such a file system, the file system has any compression enabled, then it can take advantage, and then, you know, this is what happens. Okay, same thing happens with network packets as well. So if you do some VPN and stuff like that, you may have some padded zeros and stuff like that, so it can effectively compress. So And we are not doing lossy compression, we are doing a lossless compression, okay. Furthermore, we can do some more quick debug. See, we can just do, perhaps we can print some first few bytes and see as, see what the contents it may have, okay, like a preview of that buffer, okay. So you can do a small for loop int, I equal to 0, I less than 10. Let me declare this int I, right, I less than 10. So first to 10 bytes, we can have a look what it contains each buffer, okay. We do this and we just copy this print k and bring it here and something like buff src, which is src and percentage d, and the contents is a percentage x, because we need to see the binary or our contents of each byte. Dst percentage d, and then content is percentage x, and 0 to x you can put so that it shows in 2 bytes, 2 hexadecimal notation, okay. So src buff is the buffer, so buff of I, and dst buff of I, okay. We can do that, and we see the first 10 bytes what it contains. So this should give us a sort of a clue. So we go back again, we do RM mode, and we compile this and we see, okay. See, this is how you should do kernel module writing. It's not something that you do hello world and everything you expect to work. You should write some meaningful code for whatever the purpose you want, okay. Yeah, it is throwing some error, I think percentage 0 to unsigned int. Yeah, it is expecting unsigned int. I can just typecast this to unsigned int, and so that should stop that, unsigned int. So hopefully that should stop that error. That second or unsigned int, it is expecting unsigned int percentage 0 to x. DST buff of i, src buff of I, percentage 0x, expected unsigned int argument. Percentage d, we need to also pass this I, right? We just need to pass this I, and here as well we need to pass this I, which is why it is throwing the error perhaps. So we remove this and see if it gets compiled. Yeah, it got compiled, so in that case we remove this unsigned int as well, and so we have the matching format specifiers versus the arguments, okay, for that print k. So src percentage d and then destination percentage d, so two times we are passing that I iteration, and then value of src buff and destination buff, so we are good to go. So let's compile and let's run it in smod. Yep. Yeah, you can see that the source buffer contains always this AA, which is what we have done. We have memset. Okay, so you can see there, and the destination contains all this stuff. Of course, it is having the compressed LZO contents. Okay, so it can contain the